14 Russian Tsars. Narration, Katie Haigh. Ivan IV, called the Terrible, Tsar of Muscovy. Ivan IV, called the Terrible, 1530 to 1584, Tsar of Muscovy, was the son of Vasily III Ivanovich, Grand Duke of Muscovy, by his second wife, Helena Glinska. Born on the 25th of August, 1530, he was proclaimed Grand Duke on the death of his father, 1533, and took the government into his own hands in 1544, being then 14 years old. Ivan IV was in every respect precocious, but from the first there was what we should now call a neurotic strain in his character. His father died when he was 3, his mother when he was only 7, and he grew up in a brutal and degrading environment where he learned to hold human life and human dignity in contempt. He was maltreated by the leading boyars whom successive revolutions placed at the head of affairs, and hence he conceived an inextinguishable hatred of their whole order and a corresponding fondness for the merchant class, their natural enemies. At a very early age, he entertained an exalted idea of his own divine authority, and his studies were largely devoted to searching in the scriptures and the Slavonic chronicles for sanctions and precedents for the exercise and development of his divine right. He first asserted his power by literally throwing to the dogs the last of his boyar tyrants, and shortly afterwards announced his intention of assuming the title of Tsar, a title which his father and grandfather had coveted, but never dared to assume publicly. On the 16th of January, 1547, he was crowned the first Russian Tsar by the Metropolitan of Moscow. On the 3rd of February in the same year, he selected as his wife from among the virgins gathered from all parts of Russia for his inspection, Anastasia Zakharina Koshkina, the daughter of an ancient and noble family better known by its later name of Romanov. Hitherto, by his own showing, the private life of the young Tsar had been unspeakably abominable, but his sensitive conscience, he was naturally religious, induced him, in 1550, to summon a Zemsky Sobor, or National Assembly, the first of its kind, to which he made a curious public confession of the sins of his youth, and at the same time he promised that the realm of Russia, for whose dilapidation he blamed the boyar regents, should henceforth be governed justly and mercifully. In 1551, the Tsar submitted to a synod of prelates 100 questions as to the best mode of remedying existing evils, for which reason the decrees of this synod are generally called stoglaf, or centuria. The decennium extending from 1550 to 1560 was the good period of Ivan IV's reign, when he deliberately broke away from his disreputable past and surrounded himself with good men of lowly origin. It was not only that he hated and distrusted the boyars, but he was already statesman enough to discern that they could not be fitted into the new order of things which he aimed at introducing. Ivan meditated the regeneration of Muscovy, and the only men who could assist him in his task were men who could look steadily forward to the future because they had no past to look back upon, men who would unflinchingly obey their sovereign because they owed their whole political significance to him alone. Two of these men of goodwill were Alexis Adashev and the monk Sylvester, men of so obscure an origin that almost every detail of their lives is conjectural, but both of them, morally, the best Muscovites of their day. Their influence upon the young Tsar was profoundly beneficial, and the period of their administration coincides with the most glorious period of Ivan's reign, the period of the conquest of Kazan and Astrakhan. In the course of 1551, one of the factions of Kazan offered the whole Khanate to the young Tsar, and on the 20th of August 1552, he stood before its walls with an army of 150,000 men and 50 guns. The siege was long and costly, the army suffered severely, and only the tenacity of the Tsar kept it in camp for 6 weeks. But on October the 2nd, the fortress, which had been heroically defended, was taken by assault. The conquest of Kazan was an epoch-making event in the history of Eastern Europe. It was not only the first territorial conquest from the Tatars, before whom Muscovy had humbled herself for generations, Kazan Asia, in the name of Mahomet, had fought behind its last trench against martial-led Christian Europe beneath the banner of the Tsar of Muscovy. For the first time, the Volga became a Russian river. Nothing could now delay the natural advance of the young Russian state towards the east and the southeast. In 1554, Astrakhan fell almost without a blow. By 1560, all the Finnic and Tatar tribes between the Oka and the Kama had become Russian subjects. Ivan was also the first Tsar who dared to attack the Crimea. In 1555, he sent Ivan Sheremetev against Perekop, and Sheremetev routed the Tatars in a great two-day battle in Sudbyshenska. Some of Ivan's advisers, including both Sylvester and Adashev, now advised him to make an end of the Crimean Khanate, as he had already made an end of the Khanates of Kazan and Astrakhan. But Ivan, wiser in his generation, knew that the thing was impossible, in view of the great distance to be crossed, and the predominance of the Grand Turk from whom it would have to be wrested. It was upon Livonia that his eyes were fixed, which was comparatively near at hand, and promised him a seaboard and direct communication with Western Europe. Ivan IV, like Peter I after him, clearly recognized the necessity of raising Muscovy to the level of her neighbors. He proposed to do so by promoting a wholesale immigration into his tsardom of master workmen. But all his neighbors, apprehensive of the consequences of a civilized Muscovy, combined to thwart him. Charles V even went so far as to disperse 123 skilled Germans whom Ivan's agent had collected and brought to Lübeck for shipment to a Baltic port. After this, Ivan was obliged to help himself as best he could. His opportunity seemed to have come when, in the middle of the 16th century, the Order of the Sword broke up and the possession of Livonia was fiercely contested between Sweden, Poland, and Denmark. Ivan intervened in 1558 and quickly captured Narva, Dorpat, and a dozen smaller fortresses. Then, in 1560, Livonia placed herself beneath the protection of Poland, and King Sigismund II warned Ivan off the premises. By this time, Ivan had entered upon the second and evil portion of his reign. As early as 1553, he had ceased to trust Sylvester and Adashev, owing to their extraordinary backwardness in supporting the claims of his infant son to the throne, while he himself lay at the point of death. The ambiguous and ungrateful conduct of the Tsar's intimate friends and protégés on this occasion has never been satisfactorily explained, and he had good reason to resent it. Nevertheless, on his recovery, much to his credit, he overlooked it, and they continued to direct his affairs for 6 more years. Then the dispute about the Crimea arose, and Ivan became convinced that they were mediocre politicians as well as untrustworthy friends. In 1560, both of them disappeared from the scene, Sylvester into a monastery at his own request, while Adashev died the same year in honourable exile as a general in Livonia. The death of his deeply beloved consort Anastasia and his son Demetrius, and the desertion of his one bosom friend Prince Kurbsky, about the same time, seemed to have infuriated Ivan against God and man. During the next 10 years, 1560 to 1570, terrible and horrible things happened in the realm of Muscovy. The Tsar himself lived in an atmosphere of apprehension, imagining that every man's hand was against him. On the 3rd of December 1564, he left Moscow with the whole of his family. On the 3rd of January 1565, he declared in an open letter addressed to the Metropolitan his intention to abdicate. The common people, whom he had always favoured at the expense of the boyars, thereupon implored him to come back on his own terms. He consented to do so, but entrenched himself within a peculiar institution, the oprichnina, or separate estate. Certain towns and districts all over Russia were separated from the rest of the realm, and their revenues were assigned to the maintenance of the Tsar's new court and household, which was to consist of 1,000 carefully selected boyars and lower dignitaries, with their families and suites, in the midst of whom Ivan henceforth lived exclusively. The oprichnina was no constitutional innovation. The Duma, or council, still attended to all the details of the administration. The old boyars still retained their ancient offices and dignities. The only difference was that the Tsar had cut himself off from them, and they were not even to communicate with him, except on extraordinary and exceptional occasions. The oprichniki, as being the exclusive favourites of the Tsar, naturally, in their own interests, hardened the Tsar's heart against all outsiders and trampled with impunity upon everyone beyond the charmed circle. Their first and most notable victim was Philip, the saintly metropolitan of Moscow, who was strangled for condemning the Oprichnina as an unchristian institution and refusing to bless the Tsar in 1569. Ivan had stopped at Tver to murder St. Philip, while on his way to destroy the second wealthiest city in his tsardom, Great Novgorod. A delator of infamous character, a man called Peter, had accused the authorities of the city to the Tsar of conspiracy. Ivan, without even confronting the Novgorodians with their accuser, proceeded at the end of 1569 to punish them. After ravaging the land, his own land, like a wild beast, he entered the city on the 8th of January 1570, and for the next 5 weeks, systematically and deliberately, day after day, massacred batches of every class of the population. Every monastery, church, manor house, warehouse, and farm within a circuit of 100 miles was then wrecked, plundered, and left roofless. All goods were pillaged, all cattle destroyed. Not until the 13th of February were the miserable remnants of the population permitted to rebuild their houses and cultivate their fields once more. An intermittent and desultory war with Sweden and Poland simultaneously for the possession of Livonia and Estonia went on from 1560 to 1582. Ivan's generals, he himself rarely took the field, were generally successful at first and bore down their enemies by sheer numbers, capturing scores of fortresses and towns. But in the end, the superior military efficiency of the Swedes and Poles invariably prevailed. Ivan was also unfortunate in having for his chief antagonist Stephen Bathory, one of the greatest captains of the age. Thus, all his strenuous efforts, all his enormous sacrifices, came to nothing. The West was too strong for him. By the Peace of Zapoli, January 15, 1582, he surrendered Livonia with Polotsk to Bathory, and by the Truce of Ilusia, he at the same time abandoned Ingria to the Swedes. The Baltic coastline was lost to Muscovy for another century and a half. In his latter years, Ivan cultivated friendly relations with England in the hope of securing some share in the benefits of civilization from the friendship with Queen Elizabeth, one of whose ladies, Mary Hastings, he wished to marry, though his fifth wife, Martha Nageya, was still alive. Towards the end of his life, Ivan was partially consoled for his failure in the West by the unexpected acquisition of the Kingdom of Siberia in the East, which was first subdued by the Cossack hetman Ermak or Yermak in 1581. In November 1580, Ivan, in a fit of ungovernable fury at some contradiction or reproach, struck his eldest surviving son Ivan, a prince of rare promise, whom he passionately loved, a blow which proved fatal. In an agony of remorse, he would now have abdicated, as being unworthy to reign longer, but his trembling boyars, fearing some dark ruse, refused to obey anyone but himself. 3 years later, on the 18th of March 1584, while playing chess, he suddenly fell backwards in his chair and was removed to his bed in a dying condition. At the last moment, he assumed the hood of the strictest order of hermits and died as the monk Jonah. 14 Russian Tsars. Narration, Katie Haigh. Ivan V, Tsar of Russia. Ivan V, 1666 to 1696, Tsar of Russia, was the son of Tsar Alexios Mikhailovich and his first consort, Miloslavskoya. Physically and mentally deficient, Ivan was the mere tool of the party in Muscovy who would have kept the children of the Tsar Alexis by his second consort, Natalia Narushkina, from the throne. In 1682, The Party of Progress, headed by Artemon Matveyev and the Tsaritsa Natalia, passed Ivan over and placed his half-brother, the vigorous and promising little Tsarevich Peter, on the throne. On the 23rd of May, however, the Narushkin faction was overthrown by the Strielski, musketeers, secretly worked upon by Ivan's half-sister, Sophia, and Ivan was associated as Tsar with Peter. 3 days later, he was proclaimed first Tsar, in order still further to depress the Narushkins and place the government in the hands of Sophia exclusively. In 1689, the name of Ivan was used as a pretext by Sophia in her attempt to oust Peter from the throne altogether. Ivan was made to distribute beakers of wine to his sister's adherents with his own hands, but subsequently, beneath the influence of his uncle, Prozorovsky, he openly declared that, even for his sister's sake, he would quarrel no longer with his dear brother. During the reign of his colleague Peter, Ivan V took no part whatever in affairs, but devoted himself to incessant prayer and rigorous fasting. On the 9th of January 1684, he married Praskovia Saltykova, who bore him 5 daughters, one of whom, Anne, ultimately ascended the Russian throne. In his last years, Ivan was a paralytic. He died on the 29th of January, 1696. 14 Russian Tsars. Narration, Katie Haigh. Ivan VI, Emperor of Russia. Ivan VI, 1740 to 1764, Emperor of Russia, was the son of Prince Anthony Ulrich of Brunswick and the Princess Anna Leopoldovna of Mecklenburg and great-nephew of the Empress Anne, who adopted him and declared him her successor on the 5th of October, 1740, when he was only 8 weeks old. On the death of Anne, October the 17th, he was proclaimed emperor, and on the following day, Ernest Johann Biren, Duke of Courland, was appointed regent. On the fall of Biren, November the 8th, the regency passed to the baby Tsar's mother, though the government was in the hands of the capable vice-chancellor, Andrei Ostermann. A little more than 12 months later, a coup d'état placed the Tsarevna Elizabeth on the throne, December the 6th, 1741, and Ivan and his family were imprisoned in the fortress of Dynamind, Ust-Dvinsk, December the 13th, 1742, after a preliminary detention at Riga, from whence the new empress had at first decided to send them home to Brunswick. In June 1744, they were transferred to Kolmogory on the White Sea, where Ivan, isolated from his family and seeing nobody but his jailer, remained for the next 12 years. Rumours of his confinement at Kolmogory having leaked out, he was secretly transferred to the fortress of Schlisselburg, 1756, where he was still more rigorously guarded. The very commandant of the fortress, not knowing who a certain arrested aunt committed to his care, really was. On the accession of Peter III, the condition of the unfortunate prisoner seemed about to be improved, for the kind-hearted emperor visited and sympathized with him. But Peter himself was overthrown a few weeks later.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.